Job chapter 10. Job's still speaking. He's answered to Bildad, but in chapter 10, Job is going off on his own. And you're going to find out the real character of Job and who he is and somebody who's in pain and sorrow. And that's this main thing. The main theme of the book of Job is, why do people suffer? Job, who's right in the eyes of God, like any Christian, but yet we suffer. Why? And then how do we take it personally? And the thing is, for the Christian, is when you look at Paul's writings, rejoice evermore, Paul says. Do we rejoice in the fact is that we're suffering? No, you're rejoicing that you have the hope that somebody else doesn't have. That the worst thing that can happen to you is your body dies and you go to heaven. That's the worst that can happen to a Christian. Paul suffered much. Paul, because of the sufferings of Christ, suffered his entire life. But God took care of him. A Christian is not to have anxiety. Job, on the other hand, has no security of salvation. He doesn't have the Lord Jesus Christ, as we're going to see in a minute. So to go run the book of Job for a Christian is wrong on suffering. And we'll see that as we go along. My soul is weary of my life. And still, he wants death. A Christian is to want life. Paul said, you know, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord, when he's talking to one of the churches, he says, listen, I'd rather be in heaven, but I'm here to serve you. I'm here at your benefit. If I were to be in heaven like I want to be, God can't use me to be an aid to you to what you need. You are here for a reason. And it's not for football, it's not to get the job ladder, it's not to catch fish. A born-again Christian is left alive for two reasons, and only two reasons. Number one, to go tell people about Jesus Christ. If you don't do that, if you make excuses about it, you have failed as a Christian, number one. You can't get past number one. Because you got to do number one to get to number two, and you say, what's number two? Those that receive Christ, you train them up from babes in Christ to where they can handle themselves with the Word of God and go tell other people and train them up. That's what Paul told Timothy. Those are the only two things that Christians are still here for. But if you were to walk into your average church, if you were to look at the average Christian's life, you wouldn't think that was the reason. I will leave my complaint upon myself. I'm not going to say anymore to you guys. He's afraid of what they're going to do, what they're going to say. I will speak in bitterness of my soul. He's angry. Check out Job chapter 40, verses 3 through 5 again when God speaks. How Job buckles down. Yeah, I mean, there are times of suffering, you know, we're going to get angry, we're going to get upset, we're going to say things. But we still have God who's in control. And Paul writes to the Corinthian church, listen, God is not going to give you anything you can't handle. And why can't you claim that promise? You can go in there and say, oh, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. But that's a conditional promise. Amazing how Christians go out there and grab the wrong ones. What hope does Job have? Everything's destroyed in his life. Listen, as a born-again Christian, you can have everything destroyed in your life, and you still got Jesus. That's what you believe, right? We'll look at Christians today and see how they believe that. If they lost everything, their life would be in utter destruction. Will they continue to walk on? Paul's entire life was in a prison, and when he told somebody, he said, listen, when you come see me, I have a couple parchments and three or four things, that's it, of his whole life. But he was chained to or handcuffed to men that could not leave, and all he could do is speak the gospel, and they're not going to go away. I will say unto God. Let's go to Job 40, verse 3. See what he's going to say to God when he gets the opportunity. Because we're going to keep quoting this. Job 40, verse 3. God has spoken, verses 1 through 2. Job answered the Lord and said, "Behold, I am vile. What shall I answer thee? I will lay my hand upon my mouth. Once I have spoken," 39 chapters, well, not 39, but twice, "but I will proceed no further." Job, who is righteous, backed down from God. Okay, God, I'm sorry. And so, verse 2, "I will say unto God, do not condemn me." No, you did not say that, Job. And you're going to, in your life, you're going to say some things, and you know what? You're not going to. What's a Christian to do? 1 John 1:9, "Put it under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, repent of it, and God will forget." Listen, Jesus said, listen, if you sin against me, it can be forgiven. You don't need to worry about that unpardonable sin. There are no unpardonable sins right now. You cannot do the impardonable sin. Every sin you can put under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Even in pain or anger, whatever you are, even if you yell at God. Listen, at least you're being honest. I'll give Job credit. He's honest with God. And I have been at times, listen, what my heart is thought. So listen, God already knows your heart. Tell God what you think. You think God is stupid? Tell him he's stupid. Oh, I wouldn't do that. Why? You've already thought about it. You think you're being treated unfair in what you're going through? Tell God. Because in the end, Job gets some answers. Some. "Show me wherefore thou contendest, fightest with me." He wants to know why. And I don't think it's, "Why, God, did this happen to me?" I don't think it's that. I think Job, through what we've been seeing so far, I think he's searching for the answer. What can I do to get out of this? And majority of your Christians will not do that. They are afraid to ask God because God will give them the answer, and they fear because what they're doing wrong, they enjoy. Oh, they're true. Oh, I want to know the will of God in my life. Well, the Bible tells you what the will of God is. You're afraid to ask God because God will tell you, and now you're obligated. And if you don't do it, you're in rebellion. Job wants to know. He wants to know why so he can get it right. He's beyond talking to Bildad or the other guy. He's talking to God now. "It is good unto thee that thou shouldest oppress." There's a reason he's doing. Job understands, listen, there's a reason you're doing this. I'm mad as anything, but there's a reason. You're not the kind of guy to do this just to do this because you enjoy it, like Satan. "That thou shouldest despise the work of thy hands." God doesn't do nothing to despise. You say, well, God will throw some men into hell. They despised what God was doing. God was using correction for their own good. Only America today is correction, evil, and rotten, and all that. And look what all the kids are doing today. It shows you are wrong in your teaching. You have taught the kids in utter failure. And God is right. Because Job gets right. "And shine upon the counsel of the wicked." God does it for a good reason. The good reason is for you to get right. Now, look at this. Verse 4. You know, 10:4 for the CB talk used to be, you know, right on, gotcha, buddy, okay. Receive. I don't know if they use that anymore. But 10:4, "Hast thou eyes of flesh? Job is asking God, say, God, foreseest thou as a man seeth? Are thy days as the days of man? Are thy years as a man's days? God, what do you know about being a human? What do you know about pain? What do you know? You haven't looked out my eyeballs. And in 1520 years, God answers Job. Have thou eyes of a man? And John 11:35, tears came from the eyes of God. Too bad you're a Jehovah Witness. You don't believe he's God. I'm sorry for you. Because if you're a Jehovah's Witness, you can't follow Job 10:4-5. Because Jesus Christ was never God, what you say. So Job's ply never gets answered if you're a Jehovah Witness. But I believe Jesus Christ is God and God is Jesus Christ. And I believe God's telling Job and looking over to his son like, if Job only knew, my son. And Jesus has that little smile. Yeah, if he only knew. And then all the Christians that know today are just as a heathen as Job is without a Bible, where we have a Bible. But yet Job gets right and Christians won't. That's not a prophecy. But it's about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's saying, God, how do you know? He says, God, you have any pain? So Jesus Christ was brutally treated with a cat of nine tails, had his beard pulled from his face, was nailed upon his hands and upon his feet. Okay, Job, guess what? God does know what pain is. Job, about your 10 children, Jesus went to a funeral of a loved one and wept. About death, Jesus Christ died. God died. About the resurrection Job will speak about, Jesus Christ arose from the grave. Imagine God sitting in heaven listening to Job speak like, one day, just wait. Patience. God never answers my prayer. Job prayed in 10:4-5, and it was answered 1520 years later after Job was dead, buried, just bones, dry bones. His prayer was answered. Imagine your prayer 1520 years. Lord willing, whoa, this country and what this world would be like in 1520 years. Don't go be crying to God, oh, you didn't answer my prayer, it's been 5 seconds. 1520 years was Job's prayer answered. That's a long time. That thou inquirest after me, that thou inquirest after mine iniquity, and searches after my sin. Now, isn't it amazing? Don't you see? Chapter 4 and 5 talks about Jesus Christ, and chapter 6 speaks about sin. Why did God come in the flesh and have the eyes for sin? To wash away the sin. Isaiah tells the nation of Israel through God, you know, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. No one can bear sins like God can. Only God can. Thou knowest that I am wicked. He says, thou knowest I am not wicked. Well, wicked here. What's Job saying? I do follow you, God. I'm not completely godless. I'm not that bad. God. But the Bible says, for all have sinned, come to short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. God sought for someone to fill in the gap, and he couldn't find anybody to fill in the gap. He had to come down as a man. How those verses work together. Has thou got eyes like a man? It's all fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Job chapter 10. Thy hands had, okay, paragraph mark. He starts now, God the Creator. He talked about God the Savior. Now he's talking about, excuse me, God the Creator. There is, verse 7, there is none that can deliver out of thy hand. Jesus Christ can. And only Jesus Christ. You say for an Old Testament? Yes, for an Old Testament. Because the Hebrew says the blood of the bulls and goats couldn't do it. They had to wait for the redemption of the Lamb of God. Thy hands had made me. Well, Job knows a lot more than a theistic evolutionist teacher does. Theistic evolutionist means, well, God made it, then he just left, you know, took off, went down the road, or whatever he does, and just left it. And Job does not have the Genesis account. Genesis is not written. Moses hasn't even been born. And Job, in his you know, stupidity of dragging women around by the hair and oonga boonga, oonga boonga, knows that God created all. And man, with his great technology today, has everybody out of work, everybody is broke, and we don't know if we're coming or going or where we're going, and even the churches are fouled up. So some idiot builds a skyscraper, and because of a thing, the sun is hitting the windows and burning the sidewalks and cars, and they show the picture of the other day frying an egg on the sidewalk. That brave! And yet, scientific achievement is man still dies. You just made it more expensive. Thy hands have made me and fashioned me together round about. Yet, thou dost destroy me. No, Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. Sin is what's destroying Job. Had Job been not wicked and proper and totally perfect, I mean the perfect word, not perfect as in his heart, but perfect 100% like Jesus Christ, then God would have told Satan, no, leave him alone. But then again, Jesus Christ was perfect 100%, and God allowed Satan to continue and do what he did in the life of Jesus Christ. Isn't that interesting? Remember, I beseech thee, that thou hast made me as clay, dirt. Where did he get that from Genesis chapter 2? When Genesis 2 has not been written? How did he know the body was made of clay? Where did he get that from? Probably a more direct way, through traditions and stories like that, probably a more direct way of God actually speaking to him. Working in dreams, and listen, he was a judge. He loved the Lord. Even if his children possibly did wrong, he made offerings for them to God, Jehovah, the Bible. Probably when he had a court case and stuff like that, he would pray to God for the answer. Listen, we ain't too far from the flood. All right. Thou hast made me clay, and wilt thou bring into dust again? He knows. Man goes back to dust. Well, you can dig up a body and learn that. Hast thou not poured me out as milk and curdled me like cheese? That curdle is pH drop, becomes acid. Protein molecules joined together. I have no idea what that verse is talking about. So, thou hast clothed me with skin and flesh. Oh, you mean we didn't come from monkeys? We were an amoeba swimming around in a pool one day, zapped by electricity that never was to be found, that wasn't going to be, that wasn't to be in the beginning, that nothing was there, that here we are today. And has fenced me with bones and sinews. And sinew is a tendon. You mean these prehistoric cavemen, they knew about the bones and muscles? I mean, they're not like doctors today. I mean, we got great advancements of technology. We've got all. We just can't afford you. But yet, Job knows what the inside of the body looks like. They did surgical procedures on people. They did, you know, cut open probably dead bodies, I hope, and examine. There wasn't medical things back there. They weren't stupid morons like they are today. Thou hast granted me life. Life comes from God, Job says. And favor. Air, food, and all that is a favor of God. Tell that to your modern Christian who's in a Bible-believing church before they sit down and have a meal and don't even bless the meal and give God the blessing for the favor he's allowed them to eat. I'm not talking about the lost person. And thy visitation has preserved my spirit. There you go. God visited Job. Just like God visited Adam. Just like God visited Moses. Just like God visited all the Old Testament. You say, well, God doesn't visit me today. He does, through the Word. Not television, not puppetry, not magic, through the Word. For faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word. That's where God comes to you in visitation. When you're reading your Bible, and you're going like, wow. I never saw that. That's a visitation from God. You say, well, Brother Stanley, I don't get that because you're not in the Word. It's plain and simple. Well, I'm in the Word. You speed read so you can say you did it. You just read. Listen. I read my Bible and you ask, oh, I just read the Psalms. There's 65 other books in the Bible. Well, I read those books in the Bible that the Catholics put in there. That's not Bible. Oh, I read Monkey, I don't know who I am, doctor, PhD, and all that from the television. I read his book. Ain't of God. Read his book. Pray over his book. Study the Bible, says, unless you ain't got a King James Bible. Then watch God come and visit you. And watch God work in you. And Peter says, listen, this black and white Bible red, if you got a red letter edition where Jesus spoke, Peter said, this Bible is more than those who spoke to Job, God spoken. This is more than God speaking to Adam. Because I can go up to you and say, hey, look right here. It says God spoke to Adam. Ask Adam when God spoke to him. I didn't write it down. Where was I supposed to keep the pencil? We have it recorded. Ask Job right now. Right now where we are, where he's sitting this thing, he just said it. Ask Job, okay, what did God say to you? I didn't write it down. And we don't even know if Elihu is writing as they're speaking. We know he writes the book, but is he sitting there writing it down now, or does he wait till later like the Gospels? So Job was visited by God. You say, if God would do that for me today, why? You don't read his word, why should he speak to you? You don't do what he tells you to do, why should God do anything for you? His word says, go ye in all the world and preach the gospel. And then go ahead and make the excuses like Moses did. And these things hast thou hid in thy heart. I know that this is with thee. There are some things that God would speak to them, and he hid. God would say things to them. He'd say something to the Old Testament prophets. They look back and read and say, what on earth does that mean? But yet, in 2013, Bible preachers who love the Word, who love the King James Bible, can get up in the pulpits and teach their congregation what the prophets wrote and didn't have no idea. And don't give me this garbage. Well, they look forward to Calvary. They had no idea about Calvary. Because had they had an idea of Calvary, then everybody in Israel after Calvary would have received Christ as their Messiah. If they knew about Calvary. Instead of saying, Pilate saying, because of envy they delivered Jesus to me, Pilate would have said, because of the Old Testament scriptures and the fulfilled prophecy, they brought this man to me. I am to crucify him by the scriptures, and when they're done, he's the fulfilled Messiah, and then boom, 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 that's not how it happened. If I be wicked, you see a little sin in there? If I be wicked, huh? Where am I? Verse 14. If I sin, that's even worse. If I sin, what's Job saying? Look at verse 14. Verse 15. If I be wicked, what's Job implying? If I sin, if I be wicked, what are you saying, Job? Anybody care to guess what he's saying, what he's implying? Anybody know what his sin is? No, I heard a man tell me, a preacher, who has, you know, Job's sin is not self-righteousness. If I sin, if I be wicked, you've been yelling at God. Isn't that a sin enough? Wow. Then thou markest me, and thou wilt not acquaint me from my iniquity. Well, he had to bring a sacrifice. Today we bring Jesus Christ. But if you don't bring the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you don't put it under the blood, you don't confess it, guess what? It shows up at judgment. If I be wicked, woe unto me. And if I be righteous, oh, there we go. If I be righteous, yet will I not lift up my head. He's that guy that Jesus spoke about, the publican and the politician, not the publican and the Pharisee. The publican sat there on his knees, pounded his chest, and said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said he wouldn't even lift up his face. Lord, I can't even look up to heaven. When Jesus told that parable, those Jews should have went back to Job. In their mind, I mean. Had they known the scriptures as much as they known the scriptures. I am full of confusion. God is not the author of confusion, the New Testament says. Guess who's causing the confusion? Ready? Number one, Satan. Number two, man. These two guys, I told you, have dogmatism. You know what dogmatism is? Religion. Satan and religion has made Job confused. That's why he's not right. Therefore, see thou my affliction. You don't think God sees him sitting there? You don't think, God, you don't know what it's like to be. You don't have eyes like me. You don't know what I'm going through. And if I'm a sinner, if I be wicked, I wouldn't look up to you. I'd be so humble. So humble I stumble. Well, Lord, you don't know what it's like to be like me. Nobody knows. You say you're making fun of Job. No, I'm not making fun of Job. I'm making fun of man. Because Job is not the only one that says this. But yet most of the time we bring our own troubles. God will bring them. Satan will bring them. And man will bring his own troubles. Now here's the case. Satan did it. He hasn't cursed God, but boy, has he thrown accusations. Don't you see what Satan's trying to do in his life with these two guys? Satan using these two men so far, and there's a third one coming up. He's trying to get Job to come out and say, God, I curse you. Satan's still in the picture, even though you don't see him. For it increaseth. Thou huntest me as a fierce lion. And the Bible says, your adversary as a lion, the devil, seeking whom he may devour. And again, thou showest thyself marvelous upon me. Even though, now this is where Satan getting angry. This is where Satan loses. Even though, God, this has all happened to me, you're marvelous. I don't understand it. I want to die. I'm angry. I'm fed up. I'm in pain. I've got all these troubles. God, you don't even understand. But God, you know what? You're marvelous. Now that is a confession. And that's a confession will get Job right. Or any man. God, I don't know. God, you don't. God, you know, some people will say, well, how can Jesus, he was never married. No, he wasn't. But he had 12 men hanging around with his entire life. He had a whole bunch of women hanging around with his whole life. Those disciples were always fighting. Read the account. Those women always wanted something. Read the account. That Phoenician woman, Lord, my child, like, get away from me. But my child, get away from me. My child. Jesus didn't need to be married. He went through everything by being with human mankind. What's the difference between being married? You don't follow the scriptures, that's why your marriage is on the rocks and terrible. Paul gave you a whole outline what it is to be married and what you're to do. You violate the scriptures, that's your fault. Don't blame God. Don't say, because Jesus wasn't married, he never knew. By the way, Jesus is married. And has to put up with how many women there are his bride. Forgot about that, huh? Did your wife step on you? Did your wife step out on you? Well, no. How many wives of Jesus Christ steps out on him every day for Satan in the world? And yet he still loves. Born-again Bible-believing Christians are called the bride of Christ. And look what his wife is doing for him today. So you can't say Jesus Christ is not married. Yes, he is. He's espoused. Like Mary and Joseph, they weren't married. But they were husband and wife. So see? Nanny. Thou renewest thy witness against me, and increase thy indignation, wrath, pain, suffering, anguish upon me. Changes and war are against me. So 17 implies that Job's getting worse. And these two guys ain't helping. You You got something wrong with you, and it just getting worse and worse and worse, and there's no relief. You got to read Job. You got to study Job. Job should be your second book. You want to scream out, you want to get angry with God, you got to read Job. The doctor upsets you, he's one of these three men that give you bad advice. Read Job. Are you a Bible-believing, born-again Christian doing what God told you to do? Read Job chapter 42. He's resurrected. Everybody's resurrected. His children are resurrected. He ends up in glory. Well, my children are not so. Yeah, but if you're a born-again, Bible-believing, soul-winning, witnessing Christian, as he says, going on the world, if you won souls for Jesus Christ, what are they called according to the Scripture? Your brothers and sisters. Your family. The end of Job ends out good. A Christian life ends up good in the end. Maybe not now. You may want death. Read Job. So they're putting Dr. Spock or whatever on television and all these talk shows. You ought to read the Bible. You ought to find in the Bible where your problems are. And know the place and open to it and have it marked. You ought to know Scripture, memorize Scripture with your sins. And then when you are tempted, you ought to have those verses come in your heart. No one else doesn't need to know, only you. So when that comes before you, well, there it is. There's a Scripture. The Holy Spirit can use it. All your troubles, all your problems, all your happiness, everything in your life is in this book. And if you don't know where they are, you haven't been studying. Well, my preacher has, get in the book yourself. My Sunday school teacher hasn't done, study what I'm, get in the book yourself. The Bible tells you to study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman needs not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. That isn't just for Sunday school teachers, and that isn't just for preachers. That's for every Christian. Find where your troubles are in the Bible instead of skipping it. Mark it. The Bible tells you who has marked the word of God. Get a pencil, get a pen that won't bleed, and mark your Bible. There should be coffee stains, soda stains, tear stains. There should be notes in your Bible. There should be prayers in your Bible. But today, the Christianity, the only thing that's on the Bible is a dust. Job, according to 17, pain, suffering, and anguish is getting worse. It ain't done. Wherefore, then hast thou brought me forth out of the womb? Okay, he's going back. Why am I living? Lord, you gave me life. You're my creator. Here I am. Why has this all happened to me? Oh, that I have given up the ghost, and no eye have seen me. Death. If I had died, I would not be where I am today. Had Job died when he was born, would we have a book called Job? Would we have a book about pain and sorrow and suffering? No. Now, there's one thing I don't really like about God, I'll be honest. Sometimes your suffering is for somebody else. I don't like that. Your suffering may be for someone else's condemnation, for somebody else's learning, for you to be able to comfort them. For whatever reason God has, for some reason, one of the sufferings is you may suffer for somebody else to be a testimony. Job is suffering because he's self-righteous. He is suffering so we can have 42 chapters in our Bible and read about it. How's that? Why didn't, what's his name? Why didn't Bildad say, hey, Job, guess what? You're suffering because in 2013, people are going to study your book. How's that sound? I'm suffering because of them. Doesn't sound too good, does it? God may be using your suffering for somebody else to look at you like, wow. If they can do it, I guess I can do it. Or for a lost person to look at you who knows you're a Christian and say, wow, I guess their God is powerful. You may be a testimony of your suffering. Don't give up. Don't give in. You don't know who's watching you. Now, I don't like that. I'll be perfectly honest. I don't think it's fair. And I'm just saying, I don't think it's fair. I'm not going to fight God about it. God is righteous. But for you to suffer for somebody else, that's... But God is righteous. And you may never know, like Job never knew. Well, will I know in eternity? I have no idea. Verse 19. I should have been as though I have not been. No, never been. I should have been carried forth from the womb to the grave. Stillborn. Are not my days few? Yes, they're few. Cease then and let me alone. You don't want God to answer that prayer. Imagine Job in the condition he is and God says, okay, fine. I'll leave you alone. I'll leave you exactly where you are right now without no comfort, no aid. No, Job, you don't want this prayer answered. And if you are suffering pain and sorrow, I'm going to intervene on one thing. Do not pray that prayer. Because you may be in a condition God said, okay, fine, go ahead. Do it yourself. What if you are in a condition you are because of sin and because God is angry with you and you are at a point where God's going to break you unless you get right and you turn and say, God, leave me alone. Well, fine. I was trying to help you out. Now, that's one case. I'm not saying it's every case. That is a wrong prayer to pray. That I may take comfort a little. He wants mercy and grace, and you're not going to get it without God. He's like, God, if you just leave me alone, this suffering, pain, and anguish will go away a little. If God were to leave him alone, Satan would win. You think Satan's going to show him mercy and grace? Before I go hence, I shall not return, even to the land of darkness and the shadow of death. There is no revelation of the afterlife until Jesus Christ shows up. Get that. Know that. You could not go back to ask Moses, who wrote the law, and say, Moses, where do you go when you die? Come on, Moses, you're 40 days and 40 nights twice on the mountain with God. Where do you go when you die? That's a good question. Lord, can I come back up the mountain? No, Moses. I got an important question. No. You're dead. Now shut up. Elijah did not know. The only Old Testament saint that knew what was going on, I believe, was Enoch. And he never saw death. He was raptured. A land of darkness, and darkness itself of the shadow of death, without any order, where the light is as darkness. You know what Job's concluding? What death is like to him for an Old Testament saint? The hole in the ground. So you see where they get this thinking? They run back to Job in the Old Testament and say, well, see that? Job, the prophet of the Lord, said, death is just darkness. It's just the grave. That's where the Jehovah Witnesses get it from. And how do they keep that teaching? Well, Jesus Christ was just a good teacher. He wasn't God. So you violate all the New Testament, what Jesus Christ taught, and what Paul taught, and you stay with the stupid same doctrine you've been teaching. Hell is the grave. That's it. Your life is nothing after death. Job said it. I can give you a chapter and verse. Chapter 10, verses 20 to 22. Death is the grave. Death is darkness. Death, that's it. There is no hell. There is no heaven. There it is. But I already quoted the scripture for you. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed. Show up the great white throne judgment. But it said, just darkness. You didn't finish reading. You didn't study. Rightly divide the word of God, the word of truth, to find out there is a heaven, there is a hell. So, we'll conclude there.